Joining me now on Your TV, a man that I remember first seeing with beautiful long locks of hair on Outlaws and Heroes, then interviewing everyone in pop culture as a VJ on MuchMusic, till he became Mr. Much More Music. And now, according to a new book, he is a happy has-been. Bill Welychka, thanks for doing this.
Thanks for being interested. A new book. I love talking about that. And a great intro, bringing up Outlaws and Heroes.
You bet. That's where I first saw you.
Hair.
You
By
got
the way,
it, man.
I had to cut it. It was costing way too much money in hair care products, and shampoo and conditioner. And yeah, had to cut it. But by the way, I am a Cogeco subscriber, by the way. Just want to throw that out there.
I'm glad your internet is working properly for this. And now it better keep up or I'm going to have to edit around any glitches.
So far, so good. Yeah.
I want to talk about this book title to start. A happy has been exciting times and lessons learned by one of Canada's foremost entertainment journalists. First of all, snappy and quick title. That is what kids are into these days. But I'm guessing that you're not too concerned about kids and really maybe not too concerned about these days because you use the title has been, which does have a negative context to it. Are you trying to own it?
It's funny. If you don't know who I am or what I've done, I think the book can be appreciated by anyone. If you do know my past, you'll enjoy it. And if you don't know, I think it's a great story with some life lessons thrown in there that I think anyone can benefit from, that I've learned most likely the hard way in a lot of ways. But the idea of being a has-been, I have been to some. You know, there are some that only know me from the 90s on a national platform and don't know what happened to me. I fell off the face of the earth. I've always stayed in television. I've done my career backwards. I started off on a national level, eventually made my way down to a media market here in Kingston, Ontario. And, you know, there are some viewers, older viewers that I talk to here in Kingston that don't know that I had a music past in terms of broadcasting. They just think, well, and have you always done morning shows? And so, but I think it's okay if I call myself a has-been. You can't call me a has-been. The only I can call myself a has-been. No, but again, I think anyone can enjoy it. And it's for people who, both kinds of people, might not have heard of me since the 90s. And if you have followed my career, and some have, believe it or not, which surprises me, it's for them as well. So yeah, I am owning it. Because to a lot of people, you know, out of sight, out of mind. And this is our culture.
It's very much true, really, now more than ever. And I want to talk about the career path, actually, because I want to talk about maybe the initial jolt that you would have got when you left the spotlight. Or maybe the spotlight was pulled away because, you know, it was so many years on Much, then to Much More. And you were the guy on Much More. But after that, again, out of sight, out of mind, I kind of felt like the car coming out of the side of the building, you were shot out of the Bell Media Chum universe and had the spotlight pulled away from you. What was it initially like when that transpired?
I'm proud to say it was self-imposed. Hmm. I don't know where I'd be if I hadn't have made the jump. But there was a couple of things that led up to that. With Much Music, I just became sort of wasn't comfortable with the way our presentation of music was going. You know, we came from a time where you could sit down with an artist, if it was a taped interview, a 20-minute, 30-minute, 1-hour interview, package an hour special, and it'd be awesome television, great music television. And then it became a little cut down. Live interviews were maybe kept to 4 minutes, taped interviews kept to a soundbite maybe. During Spice Girls Day on Much, huge ratings. Everyone loved the Spice Girls. But I got asked to dress up as Posh Spice. I think Rick Campanelli, Rick the Temp, was Sporty Spice, Melanie C. He had better abs than I do back then, I guess. Probably still does. But I just thought I didn't like the style of presentation of where it was going. So I asked to be jumped over to Much More Music. At that point, it just launched. And I love the idea of a channel that catered to an older demographic. it sort of was confusing in the way it launched as the Celine Dion network. But it, you know, once I got there, hopefully the parameters were broadened a little bit. I was allowed to interview whoever I wanted as long as it, you know, remained a sort of, like I said, it opened right up. Nirvana, Pearl Jam, I could showcase in our specials. You know, yeah, we had Sting, we had Sarah McLachlan, we had those typical much more music artists. But again, I remember coming back with a David Bowie interview, an awesome interview that I was going to spin into an hour special, and I was asked, "Do you think David Bowie warrants an hour special? Are people going to watch?" That's when I said, "Okay, see ya. I'm out of here. I have to justify a David Bowie hour special." I was just done with entertainment. Got an offer to go to Edmonton to host a newly created morning show for the newly branded City TV. I did that for a year. I really missed Ontario. I had a great time in Edmonton. I learned a lot in this new format, which I feeling like I was going stagnant. I just wanted a new challenge. So I did that for a year. And then an offer came to come back to Ontario and in Ottawa. And around that time, Chum was purchased by CTV, Globe, and the other interests, I think, were bought up by Rogers. And there was a few changes in Ottawa, lots of layoffs over the period of 3 or 4 years. As we just read a couple months ago, Bell Media still laying people off. They do it every year, it seems, every 2 years or whatever. I dodged more than a few bullets. Eventually, a bullet found me. I got a year package, couldn't work for a lengthy period of time. And my mom was dying of cancer that year as well. So, you know, you look back and the people say things happen for a reason. Maybe that was the reason, as I had that year to visit Barrie back and forth to Ottawa to say goodbye to my mom. And then at the sort of end of that year, an offer came to move to Kingston to work for the global affiliate here, and have been loving life here in Kingston for the past 12 years, the happiest I've ever been. Hence part of the title, A Happy Has Been. Realizing a long time ago I didn't need to be national, I didn't have to have thousands and millions of viewers. If I could be happy in a city and connect with that city on a level where I truly am grateful, then of course I'm happy. So I have no problem calling myself a happy has been. If I wasn't happy here, the book would just be called A Has Been, and no one wants to read
Yeah, not as catchy, not as catchy.
that.
I wanna touch on the state of journalism that you talked about there. You know, you talked about how, I guess, sensationalistic the presentation became on MuchMusic and how you yearn to do longer interviews with people. What do you make of what's happening now, where journalists and people who've gone to school for the industry that you and I work in are essentially being replaced by influencers who learn it all themselves?
Not just that, but when occasionally when I still do watch entertainment television, we're still getting the 10-second soundbite, and usually it's a red carpet soundbite with the host or hostess gushing over, "Oh, you look great, you look awesome. Oh, who are you wearing?" You know, I'm not hearing anything about the artist, the craft of creating music. Things I think that if you're a music fan or a fan of that artist, you want to know about. So we're getting the 10-second, 15-second soundbite still. I think we're still hearing about, you know, who's got cellulite, who's in rehab, who's dating who. All that stuff to me is just, it's meaningless and it's trivial. And I think it's insulting to the audience. And I think it's insulting to the artist as well, the audience and the artist. And so, you know, people say, well, it's all about gratification, instant gratification, TikTok videos, 10 seconds long. I think if people were given an option, if they wanted to really sink into something, an artist they love, an artist that got them off when they were kids, an artist that still gets them off, I think they would settle and watch an hour special. I see it on YouTube. Some of my hour specials I've posted up on YouTube 10 years ago, you know, thousands and thousands of hits. I think if people have the time and inclination, they, I think, miss those days. I think. I know I do. And I'm a music fan, so.
So the book itself seems to have a wide array of topics. Chapters such as slashes, porn, pooping alpacas. This is a broad sense of Bill Welychka. For someone who's purchasing this book, what can they expect?
Well, no one's asked me that yet. Talking about the book, the title of the chapters. It's interesting. When the first draft went to the publisher, they came back and said, "Why don't you title your chapters stuff? Just because it's easier to look and find a story if you need to quickly look for that chapter to recount that chapter." And so I remember going through the chapters, and for me, writing down a chapter about being, mentioning pooping alpacas, mentioning I was a parade marshal in Navan, Ontario, east of Ottawa, and I wanted to walk two alpacas, and they stopped halfway through the parade to take poops. And then I carried on. The band behind me had to do this, going around the alpaca poop. And so I just started giving these silly titles or silly chapter titles just so I can reference them back later. And then when I went to submit it, I thought, I'm keeping them. They're so stupid that you're gonna want to read a chapter called A Cowboy's Bullet. Yeah, I think the idea is to figure out what the hell I'm talking about in that chapter, and then it all makes sense by the time you get to the end of that chapter. But slashes porn, yeah, I'm not gonna tell you why that chapter is called slashes porn.
Yeah, leave a little something for the reader there. I'm curious, out of those days, and you know, all these
Good
days that you
question,
are
though.
all of these days that you are focused on in the book, are there any particular relationships that you have carried on with? Like maybe someone that you've met in an interview, but then it grew beyond just the media relationship and you still stick with today?
There's lots of times over the years, you've done two, three, sometimes five, sometimes 10 interviews with someone. There is that time where you see them again. I just saw Jeff Martin from the Tea Party last fall, and he rushed over and gave me a great big hug. So do we talk on the phone each week? No, but there are times when you catch up with someone where, there are hugs. There's lots of hugs in the book. I think more than anyone, it's been the Tragically Hip, where relationships have been formed years ago, and moving to Kingston, solidifying those relationships with the boys, and their families, especially as well, which is important to me, and which is why I asked Paul Langlois to, if he cared to, if he wanted to write the foreword when the book was done, and he said, yeah, he'll take a crack at it. And then I had to turn it into the publisher, and I let him know, emailed him, and I said, yeah, maybe next week. He said, well, I'm in Costa Rica right now. Give me a couple days. And he sent me the email of this forward, and I cried when I read it. And the forward is there as is, all in Paul's voice. It's funny, I could hear his voice as he's I'm rereading the foreword. And it's been like that with all the hip guys, just love and respect, hopefully from them to me too. And that's been the biggest kick, I think, is if you want to talk about friendships, is our boys. Yeah, for sure.
There you go. All right. Well, listen, the book is called The Happy Has Been, Exciting Times and Lessons Learned by One of Canada's Foremost Entertainment Journalists. And it's by Bill Welychka, the man sitting across from me right now. Thanks for doing this, Bill. Appreciate it.
I appreciate it. Thank you so much for the interest. BillWelychka.ca, if anyone cares, there's links there to find out more about the book.